Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the 10th video in the STM32WAT series, and part 3 of the LIN protocol. In the previous video we saw how to connect an actual LIN transceiver to the MCU, and analyze the data sent by the master over the LIN bus. We also established the connection between two transceivers, connecting the slave to the second transceiver, programmed the slave MCU, and extracted the data from the received frame. In today's tutorial, we will use the LIN protocol to transfer some command from the master to the slave. The slave will then perform the operation based on the received command. We will also program the master to request some data from the slave, so that the slave shall send the data over the LIN bus. This data will be then received and processed by the master. The connection is still the same that I have used in the previous video, but I have added a few additional things to the setup. Let me explain the connection again, and I will also show what I intend to achieve with this setup. The Nucleo board will act as the master, and the blue pill will act as the slave MCU. I have connected 4 buttons to the master MCU. The buttons are connected to the pins PA0, PA1, PA4, and PC2. The other end of the buttons are connected to the ground. This setup will ensure that when the button is pressed, the respective pin will be pulled down to the ground. I am going to use one more button, which comes pre-connected on the Nucleo board. So we have a total of 5 buttons on the master MCU. In the previous video, I have already explained the setup between the master MCU and the transceiver IC, the connection between the two transceiver ICs, and the connection between the IC and the slave. On the slave MCU, I have connected 4 LEDs. They are connected between the pins PB12 to the pin PB15. The positive terminals of the LEDs are connected to these pins, while the negative terminals are connected to the ground, with 100 ohms resistance in between. The 4 buttons on the master control these LEDs. I have also connected a potentiometer to the slave MCU. It is connected to the pin PA0, and the MCU will use the ADC to read the potentiometer value. The 5th button on the master will be used to fetch this value from the slave MCU. Basically, when button 1 is pressed, it will turn on the LED 1 on the slave. When button 2 is pressed, the LED 2 will turn on, and other LEDs will turn off. Similarly, button 3 and button 4 will turn on the respective LEDs on the slave MCU. When the button 5 is pressed, all the LEDs will turn off, and the slave will read the current value of the potentiometer, and send it to the master via the LIN bus. We need to reprogram both the master and slave as per this setup. I will simply modify the projects created in the previous video. Here are the projects from the previous video. Let's start with the master first. We need to modify the CubeMX configuration, so as to add the buttons to the project. Let's enable the external interrupt for the pins PA0, PA1, PA4, and PC2. The reason I chose these pins is so that we don't get the external interrupt conflicts between them. Let's also enable the external interrupt for the pin PC13. Now go to the GPIO tab, and enable the pull-up for all the selected pins. Go to the NVIC tab, and enable the external interrupt for all the pins. Since the master is also going to receive the data, make sure that the pull-up is enabled for the UARTRX pin. That is all the configuration we need. Click Save to generate the project. Let's define all the button variables, and initialize them with the value 0. We will also define the variable transmit, which will be used to transmit the data. When either of the buttons is pressed, the interrupt will trigger, and the XD callback will be called. Here we will check if the interrupt is called by the pin PA0. If it is, then we will set the variable B1, and also set the variable transmit. We will also reset the variables B2, B3, B4, and B5. Else if the interrupt is called by the pin PA1, then we will set the variable B2 along with the transmit variable. We will reset the rest of the variables. The same process will be repeated for the other pins as well. Inside the while loop, we will protect the transmission part by checking if the transmit variable is set. The variable is set when either of the buttons is pressed, and only then we want to transmit the data. Let's add a delay of 300 milliseconds to prevent the button debouncing. The TX data buffer contains the LIN frame that the master will send via the LIN bus. The initial data in the buffer remains the same, we will just modify the actual data bytes. The actual data byte will contain the current value of all the button variables. This is how the actual data byte of the TX data buffer looks like. The first 5 bits of this byte contains the values of the button variables. The next byte of this buffer will contain the checksum byte. Now we have the entire LIN frame, so we will send it via the LIN bus. We will only set the CS pin when the master is transmitting the data, so let's remove this statement from here, and we will copy it here. Give some delay to make sure the pin is set before the master can start transmitting the data. Now the master will send the LIN break, followed by the TX data buffer. Once the data is sent, pull the CS pin low to disable the transmitter. And finally reset the transmit variable, so that this loop does not run again. The 4 buttons connected to the master will send the data to the slave via the LIN bus. But when the 5th button is pressed, the master shall be ready to receive the data from the slave. The slave will transmit the data in this format. We will have the header, the sync field, the PID, 2 bytes of the ADC data, and finally the checksum. So we can expect a total of 6 bytes from the slave. We will call the function holUArtReceive to receive 6 bytes of data in a blocking mode. Make sure to not give a very small or a very large timeout here. A smaller timeout might not be able to receive data, and a large timeout can prevent the other functions from executing. If all 6 bytes are received, the function will return holOK, and we can proceed with processing the data. We will first calculate the checksum of the received data. The PID is byte 2 of the received data buffer, the actual data starts from the byte 3, and we have a total of 2 data bytes. Then compare the calculated checksum with the received checksum. If they are the same, that means we have received valid data. We will combine the 2 data bytes to make a single 16-bit ADC data. That is all we need for the master MCU. In the slave program, we called the function receive to idle in the interrupt mode. This always keeps the slave MCU in the receive mode, and an interrupt is triggered when the slave receives some data from the master. We cannot use this idea for the master, even though we want the master to receive the data. This is because the master might receive back the data transmitted by it, and the ADC readings will fail. You can give it a try, but do use the ID of the slave to filter out the received data. This will prevent the master from using its own data to calculate the ADC value. The master program is complete, so build and flash it to the board. Let's modify the slave configuration now. We need to enable the pins for the LEDs, so let's open the CubeMX configuration. The LEDs are connected to the pins P12 to P15, so let's set the pins as output. The potentiometer is also connected to the slave MCU, so let's enable the ADC channel 0. Leave the ADC configuration to default. There seems to be some issue with the clock setup. Modify the ADC prescaler to reduce the ADC clock within the range. Alright, that's all the configuration we need, so click Save to generate the project. So we start with receiving the data in the idle mode using the interrupt. When the required data has been received, an interrupt will trigger and the RX event callback is called. Inside the callback, we process the received data and check its validity. If the data is valid, the variable isDataValid is set to 1. Now in the while loop, we check the state of this variable, and if it is set, we will start extracting the actual data bytes from the received data. The master sends the data in the following format. The byte 0 is the header field, followed by the sync field, and the protected ID. Then we have the actual data at the third position, followed by the checksum byte in the end. Since we only have 5 bytes of data incoming, let's set the function to receive 5 bytes. Alright, now we have the data byte, so we will set the LEDs according to the values of the button bits. The pin PB12 will be controlled by the bit B1. Similarly, the pins PB13, 14, and 15 will be controlled by the bits B2, B3, and B4. The bit B5 requests the ADC data from the slave, so we will check if the bit B5 is set. If it is, we will read the potentiometer's value. Start the ADC, poll for the conversion, get the ADC value and store it in the ADCVal variable, finally stop the ADC. Now we will prepare the TX data buffer to be sent via the LIN bus. The first byte will be the sync field, and then we will have the PID. We didn't use the PID calculator in the previous video, so let's copy it here. Here I am using the actual ID of the slave as 35 hex. The third and fourth byte of the TX data buffer will contain the ADC data. The ADC data is 12-bit in size, so we need to split it into 2 bytes, with the least significant byte sent first. Finally, the last byte will be the checksum byte. Before transmitting the data, we need to enable the transmitter, so pull the pin PB1 high. Let's give some delay. Now call the function linSendBreak, followed by the 5 bytes of data transmission. Finally, disable the transmitter by pulling the CS pin low. Now we will reset the variable isDataValid, so that this loop does not run again. So that is all for the slave, let's flash the code to the board. There are few corrections needed in the code. The first one is here in the master, the B5 bit must be shifted by 4 places. And the second one is in the slave. The sync byte is 55 hex. Let's flash it again to the slave MCU. We will monitor the received ADC data in the master, so let's open the debugger for the master MCU. Here I have added the required variables to the live expression. The ADC data variable will show the final ADC value sent by the slave. Let's press the button 1 on the master. The LED 1 on the slave is turned on. You can see the variable B1 is set on the live expression. On pressing the second button, the variable B2 is set and B1 is reset. The LED 2 on the slave is turned on. Similarly, other buttons turn on the respective LEDs. So the buttons are working fine, and the LEDs are responding accordingly. Now let's rotate the potentiometer, and then press the button 5. The variable B5 in the live expression is 1, all the LEDs are off, but we don't have the data in the ADC data variable. Let's check the RX data array to confirm if the master has received the data. Here you can see the data is indeed received by the master. But instead of 1 header byte, it has received 2 of them, and because of that the entire data is shifted by 1 place. We requested the master to receive only 6 bytes of data, but it was based on the assumption that there will be only 1 header byte. Now that there are 2 of them, we will receive 1 extra byte from the slave. Also shift all the offsets by 1 position. Let's build and debug the project again. Let's press the button 5 to request the data again. You can see the ADC data variable now has the ADC value. The slave is sending the raw values, so here the value will range from 0 to 4095. Now I am rotating the potentiometer to the extreme end, and reading the value. Here you can see the value reported by the ADC. Now I am rotating it to the other end, and pressing the button again. The ADC now reports the value 0. So we can now read the potentiometer value sent by the slave. The buttons and LEDs are also working well. Let's see this entire working on the logic analyzer now. I am pressing all the buttons one by one, and you can see the data being recorded on the analyzer. Here is the first LIN frame sent by the master. The actual data value in this frame is 1. The data value in the next frame is 2. Then the data value is 4 hex, followed by the value 8 hex. Then the button B5 sends the data 10 hex. When the slave receives this data, it sends the ADC value after around 100 milliseconds. Here you can see the slave sends the entire LIN frame, with the protected ID 35 hex, followed by the 2 data bytes. When the communication is both ways, we need to make sure that there is only one device transmitting the data at a time. This is why the master is set to receive data in the blocking mode, so that there is no chance of any conjunction on the LIN bus. So this is it for the video. We were able to program the master to send the commands to the slave. On receiving the command, the slave performed the respective actions by controlling the LEDs. The slave also sent the data via the LIN bus, when requested by the master. This is it for today. I hope you understood everything explained in the video. You can download the code from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.